Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So I talked with the kids about being called a name. So I'm going to ask you, how would you take it if I were to call you a bird brain? Take it as a compliment, would you? No, of course not. Because we know that birds' heads are pretty small, meaning by the laws of physics that their brains must be even smaller. And if you've ever seen, it's always said, about once or twice a year I end up having to pick up a bird that ran into the windows of the fellowship hall. And a one-time mistake I can understand, but have you ever watched a bird just keep banging against the window? Same window, as it moved. They're not known for being particularly brilliant. So being called a bird brain certainly isn't something that any one of us would take as a compliment. But then let me ask you, which would you rather be? A bird brain or a vegetable? Well, you'd have to say that bird brain is definitely a step or two up from vegetable, right? Because a vegetable cannot think for itself, cannot move, must remain where it is, depends on somebody else for all of its nutrients, etc. So then, I think we have to brace ourselves to have some of our thought processes challenged when I say that bird brain and vegetable are not too far away from the examples that Jesus gives us to follow when it comes to thinking about our earthly treasure. I think we should be ready for the idea that our thinking maybe needs to shift significantly when the examples that he gives are things that we would normally consider insults, not praise. Now, we already saw last week, this is all part of the same passage. Last week, Jesus was talking to a young man who was disputing with his brother about the inheritance, each one trying to make sure that through the courts they were getting as much as they were entitled to. Something that we would consider earthly, maybe not the most compassionate, but somewhat wise financially. And then Jesus told a story about someone who saved up enough that he actually had more than he needed, and so he was wise enough to build larger barns to store it all and provide for himself later, something that Jesus called not wise, but foolish. So we have to be ready to have our thinking maybe spun on its head just a little bit. So we look today, verse 20 through 22 could sort of be the theme verse for the passage today, where Jesus says, "Do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on." Now, if we were to describe someone who gives no forethought to how they're going to buy their groceries, who gives no forethought to how they're going to make sure that they can be properly clothed and sheltered, we would not be thinking that we were describing a wise person. And yet Jesus tells us not to be anxious about these things, what we will eat or what we will wear, and immediately gives, as examples, the bird brains and the vegetables. Because the first example he gives is to consider the ravens. They do no sowing, they do no reaping, they do no storing, and yet God provides for them. God feeds them. And he mentions of how much more value are you than the birds. And his second example then is to consider the lilies. They do no toiling, they do no spinning, and yet even Solomon, with all of his wealth and splendor, was not dressed more beautifully than they. And of how much more worth are we than grass, than a vegetable, than plant life? So the examples we're given are ravens and lilies. They are to be our examples of how we are to approach our earthly treasure. Now, as I thought about that a little bit more over the course of the week, I thought there are a few things that I do envy a little bit about ravens and lilies. For instance, of all the abilities given to animals that I would love to have but do not possess, flying has to be the top of the list, right? The ability to just use my own wings and take off and soar, ravens can do that. And ravens can go from place to place because they can build a new nest at any time. Ravens don't save up money so that they can add on to their nest a little bit bigger garage or something like that, and then say, "No, honey, we can't move, because what would we do with this new nest that we just built?" Right? So they have freedom that comes with that, and I envy that a little bit. And with the lilies, you have to think about this for a minute, and anybody who's ever cared for a garden is aware of this. What do we put in and on our gardens? Mud and manure. And from mud and manure, lilies are able to grow into beautiful, radiant colors. That's an ability that I admire and wish that I could possess. That no matter how much mud and manure I feel like thrown at me. I could just turn that into food for beauty. Not sure I'm great at that. It's something that I envy. So there are some things, if you dig a little bit below the surface, well, being called a bird brain or a vegetable or plant life is not something we would consider a compliment. There are maybe some things that we would envy. And then if you consider even more and more, I've never heard of a raven with hypertension or anxiety issues, right? I've never heard of a lily that had body image problems or self-esteem issues or opted for elective surgery. There maybe are some simplicities that we really would love to have. And then if you consider the instructions that Jesus gives to us in the passage that we read, he tells us to not worry. That was in verse 22. He tells us to not be anxious, verse 29. He tells us to not fear, in verse 32. Well, ravens and lilies, do not worry, are not anxious, and do not fear for the future. They're already fulfilling Jesus' instructions the way that we're supposed to do. Now, that actually sounds really good. If I told you that right now I was going to give you the secret formula to never worry, never be anxious, and not be afraid, I think most of you would probably sign up if you didn't believe that I was, you know, just messing with you. Because we would love to live lives that are free from fear and worry and anxiety, wouldn't we? So how on earth are we supposed to do that? Well, Jesus talks about these things extensively in regards to our earthly possessions. And so the first thing I think that we need to recognize as he talks about our earthly possessions, and I've said this before, but I think it bears repeating, we place our trust not in the gifts, but in the giver of the gifts. Because the gifts may eventually run out on us. The giver of those gifts will never run out on us. We may face times in our lives that we have very little that we can count in the credit column. But we will never face a time in our lives where God is not with us and standing for us. So I think the first thing that we can learn from ravens and lilies and how Jesus preaches and teaches about them is that we place our trust not in the gifts themselves, but in the giver of those gifts. That's why our prayer says, not give us this day all the bread that we could possibly need for the next 30 years or so, which of course would spoil if we had it today anyway, but instead give us this day our daily bread. Now our human minds start to say, well, what about tomorrow's bread? Where's that going to come from? Same place today's bread came from. Because tomorrow we're going to say, give us this day our daily bread. And what about the next day? We're going to say, give us this day our daily bread. We're not trusting in the gifts, we're trusting in the giver of those gifts. I think that's the first thing that we learn from those ravens and those lilies. But it's not the only thing that we learn. We also learn from the ravens and the lilies that, well, our earthly treasures don't have anything to do with our spiritual status. We cannot buy our way into heaven. We cannot make donations as a way to have our sins forgiven. That's not how it works. Our earthly treasures cannot affect our spiritual status in that regard. However, Jesus does teach that our earthly possessions can be useful to us in our spiritual growth. We can use the physical things, and here I'm not just talking about money, I want that to be understood. Jesus was, but the same lessons would certainly apply to how we use our time, and how we use our abilities, and how we use even how we approach our relationships. All of the earthly things that we could consider in any way ours can be used as means for our own spiritual growth as well. We read in verses 33 and 34, he says, sell your possessions and give to the needy. Provide for yourselves with money bags that do not grow old, with a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Now this I have heard preached on a number of times, usually on something like Stewardship Sunday. Right? And the idea here usually is, this is the way I've heard it preached, that if you really want to understand what somebody prioritizes, then take a look at their checkbook. Now, there is some truth to that. But I would have to conclude that many of you have as a very high priority supporting our government. Because we all have to pay taxes. Now, how many of us really are huge fans of government? not many, and if the polls can be trusted, very few. But, I mean, there certainly are things government provides that we're all thankful for. We're glad that the fire department doesn't say, have you paid your monthly bill, before they respond, right? I mean, we can all admit that. But I think it's a little too simplistic, and it gets it backwards. It doesn't say, where your heart is, there will your treasure be. Now, there's truth to that, sociologically and even biblically, that what you're really passionate about is something you'll be more willing to spend your earthly resources on. But Jesus actually says it in the reverse, doesn't he? Where your treasure is, there will your heart be. Now, one of the ways I've heard and read this taught that I found very helpful for myself, I often, as a pastor, hear from people who say, I really wish I'd prioritized my spiritual life a little bit more. I wish I had a little bit more of a heart for missions or for the persecuted church worldwide or that sort of thing. Well, Jesus tells us, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So consider it as a mental exercise. Which will make you more invested in whether your church is thriving and doing well in the Word of God, or whether the missions programs around the world are really being successful and effective? Investing a small amount in them, or investing a larger amount in them? For instance, our church has the joy of supporting the Lohmeyer family. Now, if you were to support them $10 a month, would you care more about how well they're doing and maybe reading their newsletter than if you supported them $0 a month? Well, of course you would. What if you supported them $10,000 a month? Do you think you'd read their newsletters pretty carefully? And if something wasn't clear to you, maybe even give them a phone call or an email, and maybe contact them and find out what are the things that are really working and what are the other ways we could support you? Yeah, this is what I mean when I say that our earthly possessions can even help our own spiritual growth. That's what Jesus, it seems to me, is teaching. It's not where your heart is, there your treasure will be, although there's some truth to that. It's where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. I think it's part of the reason, if you look on our bulletin board, we have a beautiful note from Pastor Jim and Nadine Hilton from when they visited. They sent us a thank you card. They sent us an email. I know they've written to some of the others of you some cards and so forth. Why do you think coming for the anniversary event, was so meaningful to them? Because of how much they, as a couple and as a family, right at the beginning of their ministry, had invested in this very place. So to see it filled with joy and the Word of God and with people who are worshiping, that meant a lot to them because they had placed a lot of their earthly treasure into this place. And where their treasure was, their heart remained as well. That's not being particularly earthly minded. That's using our earthly treasures as part of our own spiritual growth. So some of the things we learn from the lilies, from the ravens. One, we trust the giver, not the gifts, because the giver will never abandon us. Two, we understand that our earthly treasures can even be useful to us, not to determine our spiritual status. Thanks be to God, that's been determined by Jesus Christ. We come in, beginning of the service, we confess our sins, and we receive the promise of his forgiveness, not because of our sacrifices, or our donations, or how many things we bought for the church, but because of what Jesus gave for each one of you. That's wonderful, but we can use our earthly treasures as part of our own spiritual growth. That we can use what God has given us on this earth to grow our investment in his heavenly kingdom. That, I think, is not to be seen as a burden, but as a wonderful gift. Not a how much do I need to give to this, that, or the other, because goodness knows, everybody's got a handout at some point, right? How many of you get junk mail after junk mail and undesired phone call after undesired phone call to donate to this, that, and the other, right? And a lot of times the thinking is, what's the smallest amount I can get away with giving, right? Well, I think this hopefully helps to really, I said, expect if being called a bird brain and a vegetable is a good thing, expect to have your thinking shifted a little bit. I think when we see our earthly treasure as a gift from God that can even influence our spiritual growth, we start to look for what are the opportunities that God is providing for me to use whatever finances he's entrusted with me. But even if the finances aren't really there, what are the opportunities to use my interests? What are the opportunities to use my time? What are the opportunities to invest in my relationships? Where I can give to those who are in need, as Jesus instructed. Where I can build his kingdom, not just here on earth, but eternally. And that actually leads me to, I think, the third thing that we learn from those ravens and from those lilies, although really most directly we learn it from Christ and what he is teaching. And that is, we've all heard the phrase, put your money where, what? Put your money where your mouth is, right? Because it's sure easy to talk a good game, but are you actually writing a check? Right? And it's become a euphemism that we use for all kinds of things, our level of commitment or our amount of time. Are you willing to sign on the dotted line in whatever regard? Put your money where your mouth is. That's not what Jesus is saying. I think what Jesus is saying, because he says that we should store up our treasure, we should provide for ourselves with money bags that don't grow old, with a treasure in heaven that does not fail, where no thief approaches and no moth destroys. What Jesus is saying is not put your money where your mouth is, but put your money and your time and your passions and your interests and your relationships where your Savior is. Because there's no better investment you can make. I can guarantee you will not lose a cent or one moment of time or one iota of effort when those cents and those moments of time and those efforts are being placed where your Savior is. Because then you're investing in things that will not grow old. You're storing up for yourselves your treasures where thieves don't break in and steal, and where moth and rust do not destroy. So when we consider being bird brains, not a pleasant idea at first. When we think about being a vegetable, not something anyone aspires to. But when we start to consider those ravens and those lilies and how they're able to live their lives, we begin to see there's a great deal that we have to learn. And there's a great deal of accepted wisdom that maybe isn't all that wise and perhaps should not be accepted by those of us who have an eternal perspective in Jesus Christ. For we place our trust not in the gifts, but in the giver. And we know that our earthly treasure cannot determine our spiritual status, but it can be a wonderful tool in our own spiritual growth. And in the end, we know that what we wish to do is to put our money where our Savior is, and our time and our relationships, our commitments where he is, for then not one minute amount will ever be lost. In fact, it's promised to be repaid 100-fold, not just now, but in eternity. These are the promises that Jesus gives us, so that in the end, we're not bird brains or vegetables, the way that our world would consider those terms, but instead we're ravens and we're lilies, placing all our faith and all of our gifts in the Savior, who, if he can forgive all of our sins and the condemnation that came with them, and thanks be to God, that's exactly what he has done, then he has promised to us, as it says in verse 33, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail. And we look at every earthly gift that we have as an opportunity to invest in that treasure that Christ has sealed for us by his death and resurrection and promised for us for eternity. And may the peace of God that passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds in your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.